welcome to another episode of To The Point Tutorials, a series that bypasses all the fluff and focuses on what you really want to know. Let's begin. Let's start improving our voice recordings, shall we? But most wonder, what should I use first? As a rule, using EQ in front of your compressor produces a warmer, rounder tone, while using EQ after your compressor produces a cleaner, clearer sound. It depends on your project specs, so it's really up to you. Since we're talking about voiceover treatment, I would EQ first. Let's open the EQ. There is additive EQ, which provides gain and color to the sound, and there's subtractive EQ, which effectively does the opposite. There's a heated debate about both approaches, but I won't go into it. You recorded a narration. Listen to it. Usually check the low end, mid end, and high end. Is it boomy? Then just try and cut a little bit of the low end. Is it muddy? Then try cutting around the 300 to 400 range. And if it's piercing, then cut a little bit of the high end. If you find dull parts, then you have to boost it a bit. You can start tweaking the 2 to 6K range and see if you can get a little bit of clarity. Start in small increments, especially when tweaking the high end. I already have a preset for this specific lecture, so I am going to use it now. Done. Let's move on to compression. The typical goal of compression for voiceover is to increase the intelligibility of the quietest parts of the signal. We'll do this by reducing the level of the loudest parts of the signal, then increasing the level of the whole signal by the same amount we reduced in the loudest parts. So you have your plugin in front of you. I'm going to press play so you can see the plugin in action as we talk a little bit about the compressor. It's of course muted so I can speak. Threshold. The threshold is how loud a signal has to be before compression is applied. For most voiceovers, this should be between minus 20 and minus 30. You can see the knob here, play a little bit with it, and see how it changes in the graphical representation above. Then we have the ratio, how much compression is applied. For example, if the compression ratio is set for 3 to 1, the input signal will have to cross the threshold by 3 dB. For the output level to increase by 1 dB. Then we have the attack, how quickly the compressor starts to work. Most speech sounds natural with an attack time of 1 to 5 milliseconds, but you know, these rules of thumb are kind of meant to be broken on a case-to-case basis. After that we have the release, how soon after the signal dips below the threshold the compressor stops. A release time of 10 to 15 milliseconds usually sounds natural, so we would have to go here to the release button and just go down a little bit more. And you know, start with 10, 15 and then adapt it to your project. Then we have the knee, which sets how the compressor reacts to signals once the threshold is passed. Hard knee setting means it clamps the signal straight away, and soft knee means the compressor kicks in more gently as the signal goes further past the threshold. So if we boost the knee, you'll see that the line gets different above in the graphic representation. So that's how it affects the signal. Then here in this one, we have the makeup gain, which allows us to boost the compressed signal, as compression often attenuates the signal significantly, so you can kind of compensate a little bit here as you tweak further up or down. I already have a preset for this specific lecture, of course, so I'm going to use it now. Go to the menu and choose Siegfried's voice comp, which is going to be the example that I'm going to show you in the end of this tutorial. At this point, some of the tech-oriented folks might be wondering, wait a minute, you didn't speak about yesing or mastering. Well, this is a simple tutorial for academics to improve the sound of their narrations. However, we can talk briefly about both. De-essing plugins control sibilance. Would I use it? Sure. The S sound naturally contains a lot of the energy in the frequency range where your ears are the most sensitive, but I need to be careful because it might affect the voice in a way that I don't want. You see, some languages like Portuguese or Russian need some of those sibilants to be understood properly. You know, the sh, sh, sh. Anyway, same approach applies since you need to set the values. Let's go. Sibilance plugin on. We have the threshold, we have the range, and you have the detection amount. threshold and range are going to be shown in dB, obviously. I'm going to press play so you guys can see how this works. You can close or open the threshold and start playing with the detection. So you see the yellow lines will show up more prominently as we set the detection values to a higher level. But, you know, there's no magic settings. If it starts cutting your voice or making weird noises, just reduce its intensity. Some of these plugins have presets. You can start with the voiceover preset and see more or less how this applies to your project. And then you can go from there and arrange it in a way that actually suits you best. Mastering is such a complex topic that I will only say the following. Want to squash your voice more? By all means, let's put a limiter on it and go to town. According to Avid, the company that made the software, Maxim optimizes the overall level of the audio input while preserving the integrity of the original sound. Fancy, huh? In the example you see in front of you, the threshold was set to -6 and a ceiling to -0.1 dBs. We will do this to control the peaks and tease all the audio that hit the -6 dB threshold. Great! You've done it! Your voiceover is now sounding great. Well, maybe not great, but at least it's loud, which means you now have background noise too. This is called the noise floor, and it's unavoidable, especially when you boost the quiet parts of your track. So you probably must be thinking that I'm gonna talk about noise reduction magic. No such thing. We can attenuate it a bit, but if we do it too harshly, we will damage our audio. The Z-Noise plugin can help you out. So we're gonna just take this back and just press the Z-Noise plugin, which is already in effect because I already have my track playing on the background. You set up the threshold based on the level of noise you have, and then you slowly raise the noise reduction fader. So the threshold is over here. I'm very, very careful when I'm using this type of stuff, because when you're trying to use noise reduction plugins, normally you can also affect your voice. So less is more in this department, believe me. The key thing is to record the audio in a quiet room at an appropriate input level in order to avoid noise reduction plugins. So try to avoid it as much as you can. If you can't avoid it, just use it mildly. If you start hearing artifacts in your voice, or if it sounds a little bit like streaming voice, or if it sounds almost like your cell phone, you know, like you're calling on the phone and you're hearing something similar to the voice on the other side, then it's really, really too much. All right, we're almost done. I'm gonna show you two clips now. First one, here is how my recording sounds before I used all my plugins.
Explanatory hedonism doesn't seem vulnerable to some of the objections to substantive hedonism.
Now, this is how it sounds after I worked on it.
Explanatory hedonism doesn't seem vulnerable to some of the objections to substantive hedonism.
If you're curious about the software that we used here, there is a free version on Avid's website called Pro Tools First. Not all the plugins shown here will be available, but the same concepts still apply to the ones featured there. Anyway, that's it for now. I hope you enjoyed it.